Monday, June 18th, one of the select board, it's like we have a full board, plus Patrice and Cheryl. And I, open comment or just for the library stuff later?
Library stuff, thank you.
We'll probably get to that before 7. Do you have anyone else coming, do you know?
Yes.
Oh, you do, so we'll make sure we hold off.
I'm just getting the seats warmed up.
Very good. So as there doesn't appear to be any public comment, unless anyone around the table has any public comments, we'll move on to the town administrator.
Also, for your permission to either accompany you or do the grievance for the town land. We didn't get a letter, but the school got a letter saying that they picked up about 107 acres. Dwayne called me and said, of course, that's incorrect. So we looked it up today, and what it is the 173.5 acres that the school deeded to the town.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need to go and get that corrected on the tax maps, move it from the school to the town. And I wanted your permission to.
Certainly. Did you, have you made an appointment then with Cheryl then, or are you?
Yes, 9 o'clock, July 9th at 2:30.
So that 107 would be added onto the 173? Or is that part of that?
It's part of it. The town has 178 acres total.
Mm-hmm.
The school has 2.1 acres.
Okay.
So they gave the 173.5 to the school instead of the town.
Okay.
So when you said 107 before, that wasn't a number.
It was, but they had, instead of 2.1 acres, which the school actually owned, they said the prior amount was 71 acres, which was not true.
Oh, okay.
So I came up with 2.1 acres, and I talked to Dwayne, and I said, Dwayne, how much land do you think the school owns? And he goes, maybe just a little over 2 acres, that's it.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay, don't worry about it. We'll get it straightened out. We know what it is. I have the property tax transfer. I have a survey from way back in 1948.
So we'll be there for the town.
You're going to be talking about the Lover's Lane later on. I just wanted to recap that. We have a balance of $30,833 available on the grant. I spoke with Martin about why the big difference, and to finish from his estimation of $19,258. And he was saying this and saying that, and I said, okay, I don't understand what you're talking about, really. He was talking about Big Rock and Little Rock, you know. And I said, okay, will you please call Dick Hosking and ask him if they might put an extra $10,000 on our emergency grant? And so hopefully he does that tonight.
Mm-hmm.
With the fact that he has, on why the estimate was wrong, that he made was wrong. So he's supposed to do that, but I just wanted to recap that currently.
I'm sure when he's here, we'll need you to go over that again.
Did the grievance hearing. Shades for all the windows in the building are between $2,000 and $3,000. That would be installed.
Okay. And from where?
That's, we've only gotten one bid. I'm still waiting for another one.
So this is an estimate.
Mm-hmm.
So
I just wanted to get an idea of where the sort of place is.
And,
okay.
Sunset awnings?
No, Otter Creek awnings I'm waiting for.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
And Cheryl and I actually looked online to see if we could buy our own,
mm-hmm.
and it would almost be the same thing, to buy our own.
And then we'd have to get someone to put them on. But they're the same kind of shades that, you know, the solar shades that.
Do we have money in the budget for this one?
No, we don't have anything. We're over budget in the town office building fund as it is because of the heating thing that we had to.
Right. So that this is something that we'll yeah, nice to have, but we'll probably have to wait until next year.
Right.
And put in the budget. But I would still encourage you to get the estimates so that we can base a budget number on that, unless anyone else. I mean, we've dealt with it this far. It will be nice to have our budget in place.
All right, we'll put in the budget then, when we get the firm. The mold remediation began last Friday. So that should be done this week. And that means taking away the dishes and bringing them all back clean and...
They had the thing running all weekend, the...
Do you know, have you been in there?
They haven't removed any stuff yet. No, they run the fan first, then remove stuff, then run the fan again.
It's all zipped up and closed.
Yeah, the fan was running this weekend. And Joe got the window today.
But Joe's working on the building too.
Okay, thank you.
So I can give you an estimate on the overage on the town hall when you're, sometime when you're ready for that. We're gonna have to plan on that too.
And that overage would include?
That overage includes the mold remediation, the building maintenance that we had, the unexpected furnace repairs that we had to do, and the window.
All right, so if we can have that put together, so when we are doing the tax rate, I think that's something we want to consider, depending, you know, who knows what's coming up with the state, whether they're going to have a tax rate this year or not. But when they do, we may be able to, you know, get rid of that debt that way.
Yeah.
I'm just putting it in there.
And they know to call me as soon as they're done removing stuff, so that I can get a quote for rebuilding it.
Yeah, because we want to take a look at that might be where we put in that as well.
Yeah.
The Lister budget is over by $1,500 so far. Because of the, you know, in part because of the time associated with the tax maps. I just want, there's $1,500 budgeted in the tax map revisions that you could swap over to cover some of that, but it's not nearly done yet. I mean, there's another round of grievances.
Yeah, I think let's wait until we get everything completed and then find out what that cost is, and then if there's moving around, that might be a perfect case to do that. But let's, before we do that, let's see what this is going to cost us. And in addition, if we're talking about the Lister stuff, we need to maybe have the people who did the tax maps.
Right.
And because that, is that some of the cost as well?
No, that shouldn't be the cost. I read the, I dug out the, a different file, I guess, the contract, because I had that same question, and that's why I'm giving you these figures. After I read the contract, we should all agree that we should pay CAI no monies for incorrect information that's on the tax maps. That's where I'm standing.
Absolutely, no. I think they owe us all the time that we're putting in between these corrections.
Mm-hmm.
And so that will...
There's 107 acres or whatever that was, information was right in the vault that I...
No, from what I understand, I spoke to Mike and Deborah, and what I've got from you, a lot of these tax issues are really just clerical issues that where they're not using the latest maps or surveys that were available.
Yeah.
And that's CAI.
CAI.
And we've spent a fair amount of money to do that. So
we all have, I mean, money and time,
If we're still on Listers,
yeah.
Another thing I'm thinking about, I'm not sure of this, but do we think that people have enough time to respond? And it all seemed to be a very, very quick time frame.
Well, you know, another set of letters went out.
Right.
That came to me after the last meeting. And I said to them, you know, they should have had 14 days instead of 10 days. My contemporary came in and they said, yeah, I know, you know, white. And I said, if it were me, I'd send out another round of all the letters, mm-hmm. of the letters again. Okay. So they called an attorney and found out that that was right. So that's all good.
Did they put dates on them this time?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's all, yeah, that's all good. I mean, okay. Usually you can fix stuff. Mm-hmm. You know. And because there were 500, 600 letters that went out, and only 90 people grieved the first time around, mm-hmm. I could not make myself believe that everyone knew who got a letter, what was happening. Mm-hmm. Even after talking to Ray, it's like,
right.
you know.
Yeah,
so the letter went out mm-hmm. and said, this is a second round
right.
Of grievances because of the tax map revision, so.
Have there been any, how many people responded to that?
I don't know how many people I know.
At least one in this room.
I do know that there are three people for BCA meetings, but that, I don't know how many for the grievances that are coming up. I know our appointment's at 2:30 and they're every 15 minutes, so there's a few already. On Monday, so there's a few. They have all week to get the letter in.
Can I get a sample? I guess we could all ask for a sample of the letter that went out in the second round.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Yeah, one at a time.
By the way, we did not get one for
the first or second round either.
Well, we did not get one first or second round for this piece of property now.
They handed us our first ones for the town of Moortown.
The only way I knew about this big discrepancy was Dwayne called me and he says, well, you know, what do I do? We're merging. This is not accurate. We don't want the merger to have this extra 103, 4 acres of land. So I said, I know what it is, you know, don't worry about it. Just, and the last thing I have is the Vannevicious complaint. She's all solved. She's all set for that.
Yeah, she called on, I think it was Monday or Tuesday.
Yeah.
What was Vannevicious?
Pardon me?
What was Vannevicious?
Martin and the crew were up and they were changing a culvert. They're going to change a culvert.
Right.
And she just thought it was going to be a lot more work than what it was. So, you know, there was no communication there, and so when she found out, she was fine. And the guys went up, and I think at the end of the day, they had to finish the job, so she saw, you know, a job that wasn't complete, too, so either way, she was happy. But she wasn't for a few minutes. Also, if we're talking about come up, I know you have.
It's in your reports and communications.
In the reports and communications. And that was on this South Hill.
Yep.
And that, I went up and I took a look at it. It's just Clarence. I don't know if you guys know Clarence. Everyone knows Clarence. He's out, I don't know, reclaiming some of the ditch or the, mm-hmm. you know, it's harmless. You know, right. Martin goes through the grader, it'll take care of all that mm-hmm. stuff. He puts up cones and he's standing there and he's hoeing stuff, but I think it's someone that's has a lot of time, so it's probably good for him to do.
Yeah, he's a rebel.
He's exercising his rights on his property.
Well, I think he's not even on his property. Yeah. He's on Catherine's property.
That's what?
He's on Catherine's property.
Catherine.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I defer to Ray on this, but isn't it good for roads to have grass over there? Doesn't it stop erosion and runoff?
There's two ways to look at it. It does, but then it also holds water in the gravel as well.
Mm-hmm.
So
my only concern was it was making it a one-lane road.
Just talking to Martin, it didn't seem like it was anywhere that narrow.
Looked at it, and I don't think that's too big of an issue, but if it needs to be more, we'll deal with it. But I think he So Ray, you got anything for us tonight?
No. I did talk to Martin about the lady that wanted the gravel taken out.
Catherine, whatever.
He was fine with that. He'll do it sometime this summer. He knows exactly what needs to be done. He's done it before. Basically, the gravel comes down into the brook there, off the road, we retrieve it. So, no big issue.
Who are you, Kelly? Nothing. John?
Yeah, I got a bunch. First, I spoke with about the financial committee, Don Maraca, and so he was interested to do it again. I didn't get really any negative reaction, but I said that we had changed it from investment committee to finance committee. And I said, because it'd be investing per se. So we'll see. But he's agreed. He's agreeable. So we need to go to time. Can you get contact information for, let's see, Becky over there
and
Bob Holden?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And is there anybody else?
Mm-hmm. Just okay. Jason.
Okay. We'll get in touch with that. I went to several of the grievance meetings, and I've had some follow-up from some people. Sherilyn told me that Steve Maynard was in and was quite upset because he had the survey map. They had the survey map. They led them to believe that it was going to be corrected, and they get the letter, and it's not. And the same thing happened with Becky Osier. Same deal. Mike especially, would say in the meeting that this is what we think is going to happen, and so on and so forth, and then they get the letter, and it's different from what they said.
Those are two of your BC meetings.
Right. So those are, just so I clarify here for everyone, and so during the grievances, Mike is, or the listeners are saying, this should happen, this should be corrected.
Right. And well, I mean, if they brought in information that was pretty cut and dry,
right,
he would say that, and then...
Subsequently, they would get a letter that right. says, no, you were denied.
Right, or it wasn't exactly the way it was presented in the meeting. So, but that's, again, that's comments that, Sherilyn received, that I received, so on, so.
I guess we'll all have an opportunity to hear them at the grievance hearings, or not grievance, the
BCA.
BCA.
Mm-hmm. But anything that's settled with the listers then won't appear for those. Will be done.
I'm sorry?
Anything that they can settle with the listers doesn't get to the
exactly.
Right. 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 Yeah.
And they couldn't right. settle with them. So.
Right. Yeah. Other thing that Wilma and Jerry Maynard had said that the speed by their house is just unbelievable. So I had emailed Cheryl to see if we can get some type, they wanted some slow down signs or something, I don't know.
Well, yeah, I talked to Joyce Manchester, she's our tech rep, and that's the best way to get signage and things taken care of is through the Central Vermont Regional Planning Commission.
Mm-hmm.
So I mentioned to her about the Gallagher Acre speed too that Laura Gans mentioned.
Right, yeah.
And I mentioned about the sign, they could put signs up for Jerry Maynard,
mm-hmm.
On either side of the Maynard snack bar so that they know where it was.
Right.
And I also let Dick Koski know, so
okay.
The wheels should be in the works. And Joyce is coming in to whatever, are you meeting on July 2nd?
Yes, when we get down there, we'll need to
okay. So whatever date you decide on that, she's coming in, and hopefully she has some information for you.
Okay.
Back to the tax grievances for a moment. Do we get a list of the number of people who go to the Lister's grievance meetings and what the outcomes are?
No.
I'm thinking we could use that in discussions with the company that did the work.
Yeah. I think Sherilyn has a list. Mm-hmm. Some sort of list. She had that today, I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I imagine she, the police.
I was on it and it said it was fixed, so whatever that list is, she has something.
Okay. So that's both who came in.
I think so,
and
yes.
What the outcome was.
Yeah, okay. I think so.
Okay. Yeah, and then let's see, I had a Rich River meeting, a Central Vermont water meeting, and then also we went to the Planning Commission hearing, which was really quite easy. So Carl was the only one there.
On the subdivision regulations.
Yeah, on subdivision regulations, right. So, but we're going to set the date on that. So it everything looked pretty good.
Okay, Jason, thank you, John. Appreciate you attending all the meetings.
I know.
Nothing. And I, Gideon and I have heard Helen Benavicius we talked about. But then that, I think that was it. So,
about the state budget. Anything to report?
Quite a bit, yes.
Yeah, I imagine there's a, it's just sort of an exciting place to be working down there right now. So, you know, while we wait just a couple minutes for Martin to get here, the Lover's Lane stuff, why don't we, this is just reports, this is again from Helen.
Yeah.
Suck it up.
While Martin was here, if you want to ask him about this, this is a rental agreement with HP Fairfield for the mowing machine.
Okay.
And it's for $3,000, so I didn't know if you had questions for him on that. I've got a question.
We have a memo from Sherilyn, but she's looking to transfer money to pay off our TAN and AP expenses. So we're looking to transfer $120,000 to the general fund, from the savings reserve fund to the general fund. Mm-hmm. So that's again what we agreed to at town meeting rather than doing notes.
The rates must be going up, so we're saving more money.
Has everyone had an opportunity to read the final facts from the hearing we had last week on the trail?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right, so you know what, why don't you?
That's the one.
Yeah. Why don't you take a couple minutes? Actually, everyone, Jason, do you have a copy or just another?
I have a copy. I gave it over to you today.
There, Jim. You can put that down there. I'll get two of them first, just so everyone can keep having to take a look at that. Hey, Martin, how are you?
Hi. Good.
Get right to you, Martin. We just need a couple minutes before you're on the agenda, so getting caught up.
Want some cupcakes?
So tell us about those cupcakes. Here. Where do they come from?
Cheryl made them.
Thank you. Martin, do you feel constrained? Is it because you're back there?
Oh, no. Very good.
Thank you.
So I
Well, why don't you bring it to here? Otherwise at home. Mark, why don't you pull up? Why don't we get to your business, or our business to begin? Take a moment, send it.
Yeah.
How's everything going?
Good. Pretty good, then, yeah.
Any news this afternoon?
Not that I've heard of yet. Another strong band coming through, I guess, a little later.
Is it?
Yeah. We'll see how we can get home.
All right, so we had questions on the Lover's Lane bids. We had two bids come in.
Yeah.
I can't remember. I know there's a significant difference.
DuBois Construction, $40,810. And Griffin, $54,250.
So obviously we're the low one, but we have no idea what it encompasses, what it includes, you know.
Right. Yeah, I'm not sure why they, Griffin went with itemized. I told them both. There was just two contractors that showed up. I had called four. These two showed up, and I told them that lump sum would be fine, and I'm guessing that's why DuBois, Jeff Newlands, was just a lump sum bid, and Griffin, I guess, just chose to break theirs down. So I just did verbals with both of them. We walked through the job site, going over the work that needs to be done to get it up to state specs. Quite honestly, I think it's all right the way it is, but the state would like to see some of the stone that's in place removed to about a 3 foot mark, 3 foot layer. We moved bottom, about a 20 foot slope, so 10 to 12 feet of that bottom slope replaced with type 3 stone, which is a 2 to 3, 4 foot stone, which we have some stone on site from a previous job that was left over, I guess, and left there for a job like this. So it'll be whoever gets it will be using some of that stone and then hauling in some stone to get that type 3 stone at that bottom 10 foot mark. So they're really, and then what is there will be used to build the top back out to that. So it came in a little bit more when I estimated the job. I was estimating it basically leaving most of what was there intact and then just shoring up the very outside edge of that.
So that's the difference.
That's the difference in my estimate. And there's plus at one time there was just the original tree and root ball that came down that I believe caused all the problems. That big ash tree, it looks like, with there's two or three trees in the clump with a large root ball tipped over into the river, causing the ice jam up there. And it started that backwards whirlpool action, which is what carved into the bank. Now there's six trees with root balls there because that main root, large tree and root ball is still there. So it's just collecting. I think it will continue to collect. So those trees need to be removed. I've spoken with Jared Borg, stream alterations engineer, and he says from the state standpoint they'd be happy to see him stay, but if they have to go, they have to go. So
fish have to
definitely. But yeah, I think it's may never cause another problem again, but I could see the ice definitely jamming up on all this exposed root debris, tree debris, and it's just going to cause headaches for us, whether in that specific area or upstream again. Mm-hmm. I just assume I would like to see him go.
Is that included in these bids?
It is, there was for tree removal.
Okay, so run that by me again. Let's see if you would have any trees there.
From the state's fine with leaving the trees.
State's fine with leaving.
The trees are all, none of the trees are going to be live trees. They're all gonna die. The original tree and root ball were live trees that toppled into the river causing the ice jam. But there's so much root ball exposed to the air and stuff, it's not going to stay living. And then the five other trees that have jammed up behind it are all dead. Trees that have fallen upstream and floated into here and gotten caught in that root ball. So the state's fine with leaving them because, as you say, it makes great fish habitat and whatnot. But my concern is that it's just gonna, ice will jam up in there every year. And whether it causes any damage or not, it will be, if there's gonna be any damage, it's going to be there because of the ice jam. I think if they're removed, the ice will flow downstream until it can become somebody else's problem.
Is Larson on that property?
Yes, I think so. Caleb Dean has been deeded a large portion of that land, and that may be part of his, where our stone sits is Caleb's. And I've got verbal permission from him to get on site and use that.
And obviously, it's okay with it.
Correct.
Did they, not saying the design, did they ask for any, like, other material about the water level so trees could be reestablished and all that?
No, right now it would be all rock face.
That's true, that would be.
Yeah, I thought that, you know, I thought the state was kind of moving towards that.
Is that something that we could ask?
Why you do it on the lot?
Right.
It's just, maybe it's just a cost of.
Right, there's a.
Well, I mean, is that something we could ask for, you're paid to do, not just come and do it?
Right, there will be some ditching on the opposite side of the roadway. That material could go on top of that stone. You know, as a grubbing material that would probably at the very least accept grass. You'd probably have to get it a good 18 inches, I would assume, to get grass to, you know, to not burn.
I think that's what it is. But yeah, if there's some ditching material, I think the state will look favorably.
Yeah, I can check with Jared and see what, if nothing else, it would say trucking it out. So it may not, it may be a wash with the contractors.
Martin, what's Jared's last name?
Borg. B-O-R-G.
B-O-R-G, thank you. So the rock that your big rock that you're taking out to put in the small rock, you're gonna use that big rock or is that a credit?
That will be used. So he wants 3 feet of the slope excavated to, and then the rock on site that is stockpiled from previous work will be placed in to the bottom 10-foot slope to get the type 3 criteria met. What is excavated out of that slope will then be, the larger stuff will be used on the top slope, and some of that still needs to be built out. There may be a few loads that the contractor will need to find something to do, whether they take it or, but it's gonna be, it'll be fairly clean, but there'll be some dirt and stuff mixed in with it.
Do we need any fill in it? Do we need any fill in it?
I mean, if they're looking for a place to get rid of it, that'd be a danger, but I suspect both of them seem to have to pay for it down the road.
So would the statement of work for this essentially be this defined section of Lover's Lane according to state standards, plus remove those trees, is possibly what we were talking about just now, digital material?
Yes, it could be a very, you know, simple RFP. Jaron gave a very, you know, basic drawing here that I emailed along. So it has the numbers here and the, you know, what they're looking for. It doesn't break down any of the fine details, doesn't include the trees or, you know, things like that, but it basically gives them what the state's looking for.
All right, so you're comfortable then with this bid that would cover everything?
I'm comfortable with both bids. They're both, I mean, yeah, I'm comfortable with both, either bid. I mean, it's, I guess going with a verbal commitment like that, there's always the chance of things not going exactly the way you want them, but they're both preferable.
Right.
Contractors that we've used in the past have always treated the town well.
Yeah. I think in this situation that these are fine. I think going forward, we want to make sure that we do a more thorough process, make sure we have things
itemized.
Yeah, just so we can, that way if the state comes and says, well, you're not meeting our standards, and that's what you conveyed to the contractors. The contractor said it was, and then there's no, you know, gracious, you know, what she said to him, you know, just...
Yeah, Jared will be on board with this project anyway. He'll be, you know, there, meeting with the contractors and kind of overseeing it as well.
Yeah, and this is no reflection on the contractors at all. It's just more protection for the town to make sure that everything's easy and transparent for everyone.
Yeah. And as you know, we have in the past had some issues where
they
were paying on different things and
stuff. Correct.
So I think we asked for bids. So if you think they're equal bids, or this job, do police construction is going to get the job done, I'd move to accept their proposal.
That's right.
$40,810. Seconds. Any further discussion?
Mm-hmm.
And seeing none, all in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
All
right,
so.
I'm afraid of reading.
All right, so then, here you go, Sean.
So I'm not that familiar with the process for doing an itemized or when the formal statement of work. Is that something that the office prepares for you? How does that come about?
Not really. I mean, I think that's where we're off, you know, where we're kind of in a state. So it's not an area of expertise for me to do the RFP. In my opinion, I'm capable of doing it, but then it's almost like putting the onus of error on me. If it should happen to fail down the road, everybody's going to say, well, Martin, you know, the proposal was not adequate because it didn't, because it failed. So I'm a little gun shy about drawing, you know, not an engineer.
So in a case like that, what you do is do your job by bringing up the RFP, and then make sure it comes to the board, so the board approves it.
Right.
So once that happens, then it's off your shoulders.
Right.
And regardless, it's not your fault. You know, so
no, I'm going to do the best that I can.
Exactly.
But
if we take a look at it and we approve it, and then something should come back. So, hey, you guys, the board's the one to approve this.
Right.
So this is a little bit different than some whereas you have Jared.
Right, exactly.
Jared is the stream operation engineer. Mm-hmm. He's more or less calling the shots.
Yeah.
So it's really his design.
Right.
Whereas some of your other jobs are more
building.
Which really simplifies what the statement of work would be for an RFP, because you basically do what he says.
And Patrick Ross would write up the RFPs like for the Lord Brook. Ross Colors and stuff. Patrick would write out what needed to be done, so you could kind of use that for sculpture.
Yes, because I agree with what you're saying. If you get too specific, then the onus is on the town. If anything is missing, you know, hey, that's what we asked for.
Right.
But you can avoid that.
It helps to deal with, you know, reputable contractors too. I mean, they're, like I said, I don't become comfortable with either one of these contractors doing the work. It's just, you know, down the road, if there's multiple bidders and they're not people that you've used before, I mean, there's a history of, you know, this is what was called for, we met the standard, and, you know, but it's not to what we wanted, so.
One of the other things, Martin, there's a couple of summer review process that we're looking at. Something we need to take a look at. I've shared some of it with Ms. Yance, some ideas that she can share with us.
Well, just what I told you, well, it's on Katrina right now, but this is the same thing that I went over with Katrina, only her things weren't, you know, directed to the road-proof things, you know, the safety and things like that. Hers were more directed to administrative work. But these, some of these things are what VLCT, were safety things, when they came and they talked about. So I just put these in some kind of form, and you can change them or add or whatever. But I was thinking that summer and winter or spring and fall or whatever, that you might want to sit down and have your employees evaluate themselves on what they feel on this, and then you can discuss it with them. I don't know, what do you think?
No, I think this is a good idea as far as setting up a, at the very least, an annual review process. Right now, we don't really have anything, at least as a road department. I think that's probably an area where I am dropping the ball somewhat on, you know, defining that role as a road foreman. Am I responsible for employee reviews, or, you know, the select board's job to do employee reviews, or, you know, so need to clarify those roles, I guess, a little better and get.
That's right. I think what you should do is just take a look at this, and then maybe you and I can get together and get some thoughts as to clarify those roles.
Right.
Because some of it would make sense for certain, maybe the select board to be involved with, but you're on the, you know, on-site supervisor, we need your input on some things as well.
Yeah.
And then we need to certainly sit down with you and both of these things.
Especially safety.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that an annual review as far as performance, maybe a couple times a year as far as safety and other things that we should be doing for each season, and maybe that's something that you do or not. But why don't you take a look at this, and then why don't you email me, and we'll try to get together in the next month, sometime during by the end of July. Mm-hmm. So in August, so we have something for the fall. I'd like to get this done so that we can do that.
Yeah.
Having them fill them out first, because that's what you do with me, is actually really enlightening. I was doing things better than I thought I was. So, wow. You know, it was really good to do it that way.
Yeah.
It opens up a point of conversation.
Yeah. Right? Yep.
Yeah, and look, I'd like you to kind of see things we need to add or not, or if, like, you know, you're going to get a little bit better, maybe another talents what they have for their
right
review process.
I'll change anything or add anything, whatever.
And then we need everyone on the board take a little time to go over and make out some of your jobs or what you do, some ideas of. Mm-hmm. What we should be doing there as well. So, is there anything else for Martin?
I had a very minor question, but there are a couple of really big oak trees on Hathaway Road, and they're getting to, you know, there are getting to be some gouges in them or something. I have no idea what.
Are you referencing the narrow gap there?
Yes.
By Siegel's.
That's
there,
right.
Yeah, a couple of maples. Been there a long
the sugar maple.
Those huge trees are sugar maple?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I was just gonna ask.
All the galleries from the wing.
From what?
The wing.
Yeah.
From the block.
I know it's really tight there, but if you could ask the guys to be careful.
Well, it's my rule, so. I can ask him to. No, it's a.
You don't want to bounce off that tree.
No, it's usually going super slow and I'm just trying to push it back. And tell you, it's not an easy job. That's all I guess I've got to say.
We've had a meeting up there.
Yeah. They're actually going to be taken down right here. Craig died. He didn't do that.
I know Craig always wanted to get rid of those trees.
Yeah. I mean, I'd like to keep them, but at some point, but it is a choke point in the road for sure. Yeah, I'll mention it to the guy that lost it.
And speaking of trees, the last butternut for my
place is dead.
We should take a look and
come and see what we did. I have a nice young butternut, probably about the foot and a half, coming up on my property. Extremely careful around that, because there's not many of them anymore.
There used to be so many.
Yeah, very few.
That's what we named our road.
Yeah.
Is this okay for the signs, is the more tight?
Yeah, not to go off on the impression, but can you get butternut saplings anywhere?
Tim Schmaltz, who lives up by me as a state anthropologist, and he has some that he thinks might be resistant, but it's planted. I haven't talked to him about it for a couple of years, so we'll see how it comes.
Oh, that works.
Similar to like the Dutch elms, some sort of fungal.
But you never know. Right. The one in house field.
Yeah, no,
it's
that
huge.
Huge
and
beautiful.
Yeah.
Exactly. So, the only thing I've got is doing some repair on Fairgrounds Road. It's over by Cobb Hill. Garbage truck, I guess, took out the fire hydrant. So they had to dig down and replace that fire hydrant. There's two shutoffs that are in our apron. So we're working, long story short, basically we had to dig the entire apron up, or we didn't. Kingsbury did the work for Duxbury Water. But we'll have to put some pavement back down there when the shutoffs get the height is established on the shutoff. So preliminary quotes have been like 4,000. So it's going to be a fairly hefty bill, but something that the town's responsible, I mean, the apron was absolutely horrendous there prior to this, which is part of the reason that we decided to just dig it up, because something's needed to happen there for a long, long time. So we'll be, I'll shop around a little bit, hopefully we can get it down. I've even thought about possibly doing it ourselves, but we need a roller for compaction.
And was that, who paid if the garbage, was it a garbage truck for that?
Took the hydrant out, but that was on the shoulder of the road,
right?
Not in the apron. The shutouts were in the apron, but there was basically no pavement left in the apron anyways. It was one of those things that we were looking into doing anyways, so Kingsbury dug it up for us. And then we'll go from there. So, but it's going to be a little bit.
Otherwise, how are you in your budget?
I don't know.
You're good.
I'll need to get a copy. We have the pickup is due for inspection in August. I'm going to try to get it in and get a list of things that will need to be done before the inspection is due, but I think it's going to be a very expensive inspection. I budgeted for body work. That was chewed up very quickly this spring and brakework and a spring, a broken spring. So that money that I budgeted for the bodywork is gone. So it'll be interesting to see if we can get a sticker on it to at least get us through one more, but it's pretty rough.
Now that's a, where yours at, Bob?
11.
How many miles is that?
75, I want to say 75,000.
That's the hard miles. I mean, the first 30 or 40 that were just running around the road.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. It was done the first two, it was almost half the mile.
My house was just on the road running.
Right. So
stored, so they weren't so bad with the news.
Yeah. We'll have to think about that if, you know, definitely something at budget time or not.
What sort of bodywork is the problem, isn't it?
Cab corners, rocker panels, all that type of stuff. Is,
okay.
So I'm not sure. Everybody's telling me that they won't inspect it as is.
Yeah.
Everybody, by everybody meaning not certified inspection plans. So we'll see. That's why I want to make an appointment and get it in and see what they say.
You know, my husband is a certified inspector. You know, I stop and look at it for you.
Yeah. Maybe if he's willing to do that, that would be great.
The guys are usually there later and it won't take him long. I'll
right.
Ask him.
He can just take a look at it and say
okay.
Yeah or nay on the body work.
But if
you
would pass it.
Right.
Yeah, I'll ask him.
Great.
Yeah, back on the trees. I forgot the emerald ash borer is here. Calaulia orange in the Washington counties and the Orton's at the western
most fringe of it, yes.
Yeah, so.
Not good.
This is a really dumb question. It's just because I really know nothing about this. But is it possible to have a secret speed limit for garbage trucks on a regular route? Because when they're going round and round and round, you know, they get used to it and they go a little fast. Can it be 20 for garbage trucks and 35 for everybody else?
For garbage trucks, maybe. They're, you know, they've got a job to do, not a good, an easy job. It's just frustrating with them, and you'll have the garbage truck go through and then 2 hours later, the recycle truck goes through the same road. It's like, oh my goodness, but what do you do? I don't know the answer to that question at all.
That's a wasted statue.
Yeah.
So.
I think generally, everybody's driving faster in their roads.
Yes.
I could pass my house sometimes.
It was pouring down rain. You could basically see on the river road, and I bet people were still going 55, 60 miles. Mm-hmm. I mean, the roads. Just wet and I suppose it's what it means. Shouldn't be, but
it was.
All right, and everything
else, yeah, we're, speaking of safety, we're attending, Rob and Sean and myself are attending an OSHA 10 class to Vermont League Cities and Towns, Vermont Road. That's, we did our first, it's OSHA 10 hours of OSHA training. So we did our first 6 hours last Thursday, and we'll do our rest of it this Thursday. And then that will, it's a prerequisite for any of their equipment classes. So we need to get this out of the way for a grader class or aspirator class, any of those type of classes. So
that's great. Were they done at ADC?
No, we actually did that, doing it in Richmond. I applied twice for this, going back to last fall, and the classes broke up really fast. So I missed the first cutoff for the one last fall, and I was asked to put on the waiting list, which I slowly was, and then they had one come through that was being done in East Montpelier, and I called up to check and see if our names were in the list, and that class was full, and our names were not on the list, so. Just wanted to ask them, you know, that they had changed to a different computer system. So our name's been lost, but they planned this one, I guess, anyway. So we were able to do that.
Good. All right.
So as far as scheduling work on Lumber Lane, need for more funding for before we can actually work, or is this?
I think we're gonna have to be, I mean, the state's probably gonna require us to do the work regardless. So I don't know if it's up to.
Cheryl mentioned earlier about you contacted.
I tried to email him last Friday, and I got my email sent back, so I don't, obviously don't have the correct email. I thought it was. Yeah, at Vermont.
You might have put an S on his name, it's possible.
Possibly, yeah.
I'll send it to you in the morning.
Okay, because I just, yeah, I've got it. So I'll find out what he's got available. We're gonna be probably in the $20,000 shy right now with my estimate.
We've got $30,888.
Left.
Left.
Okay. So closer to 10 than 20, which is good, but. Again, you know, worst case scenarios, we would have, just have to find a way to cover it out of my budget, so. But yeah, after all the warrants clear, maybe I could get a copy of the budget and review that and see where it might come from.
Yeah, but if you get on the MVP, it's got anything that would help, that would be great. Pretty good work.
Good work.
Will you be in touch with Jeff then, or tell him ahead, or?
Yes.
Could I?
It's up to you if you want to kind of give me a call.
Were you gonna talk to, were we waiting for more money, or was that waiting for more money, or?
I think regardless.
Well, we're gonna have more of $10,000, we're looking for, but as I said, we have to do it, and while they're able to cover it through the budget, we'll have to take something else.
So I think we're gonna go ahead with it. It'd be a great time to do the work, right?
It is a good time to do this one, and I know they've done it before, the first October, anyway, so.
I don't think so.
And when we ask for the additional money, is there anything specific we should ask about in regard to the additional work that you were discussing? You know, regarding the ditching and the possible trees, anything?
I can mention it to Dick about the grubbing and see where the tree should be included in the bid. The grubbing wouldn't be because we didn't discuss it. And then, so, I can mention that to Dick when I, you know, do it. I doubt it will sway in one way or the other, but if you would like it done that way, and I talked to Jeff in there. Like I say, it may be an offset rather than trucking it out, they just put it on top of the stone.
Good.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
What's that?
This is.
You want me to sign it, or they can sign it?
Okay, it's my street wall.
So I just got, a message that there was a possible tornado went through the valley on that last storm, and Ellen Neal's farm.
Oh, really?
Farm left destroyed.
That would be surprising, right?
Yes, just tonight.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's a crazy day.
Mm-hmm.
What's wrong with the others?
No, I was just looking at the radar.
All right, well, it's been a crazy day, so we got the library in the store.
Yeah. I think the Cory's coming too, as soon as.
I thought this was coming. Did Denise decide not to come, or?
I thought she'd be here.
So wait, you want to hold up, grab yourself a cupcake if you'd like?
I don't know if you heard Jamie say Cory's gonna close the library, close at 7, and then she's gonna join us.
Gotcha.
Dad, much more up your feet.
Yeah, so I don't think that comes in here from the store.
So you must be Callie. Hi, I'm Elizabeth Burke, treasurer of the library.
I totally forgot to bring my daughter to the library today.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Oh, she was supposed to start volunteering.
She has been on Mondays.
Well, she's been busy being on the top.
Yeah, and she still has my kids this week too, so.
Oh, that's important.
Yeah.
Very good. You, so. I think where Denise was getting at, she's not here yet, though.
Want to wait a couple minutes?
I think we're gonna wait, because I know she was having some.
Why number one?
Yeah, if you don't mind, we're waiting.
This is short. Do you have a little agenda item you want to stick before us, and we can come back and.
We can do that.
Sure.
This is the one we're, are working on here.
We'll give a couple of...
For Munchin's Cupcakes, Munchin's Cupcakes, the social media policy.
Did everybody look at it?
Did everyone have an opportunity? That should be small.
It was easy, I just filled in the blanks since VLCTs.
Yeah.
So...
My first issue is, I don't know if you guys have a copy of that, maybe not. But in the second paragraph, it has a statement that basically says you can discuss, you can have discussions concerning town business when the administrator approving all such things. That's where I have a little difficulty when we started talking about the town business on Facebook.
So can I show you one thing on there? I'm sorry, I don't have a copy with me. So there's two different ways to do this policy. This is the purpose of the policy. But then when you go on to look at, oh, you know what? This isn't the right one, that's why. It's a VLCT one. That was the first one, and then VLCT came out with one that I sent out.
The one that John has is right.
Yeah. And on that, I wanted to point out, so it shows two different ways to do social media. One is just any social media site you use is a website. There's no discussion. Anything that's put on there is from you guys with permission to whoever to put on there. There's no one can respond, no one can send messages, no one can comment, none of that. And then there's another way where you can have a discussion and comment, but I wrote right on there that that wasn't the one we would use. It would be the other one. So it's just a forum for information to go out, nothing in. And no one else can write on the page but the administrator.
So Ray, you want to get, make sure you get the correct policy. Why don't we resend the policy? I know it's been sent several times. I'm not really ready for this opportunity. Callie, you will be resent, but make sure everyone has. Thank you for your patience with that. Yeah. Sorry, why don't you roll on up, Denise? Tell us what happened to you.
Oh, come on. This is new.
No, in the chair. Yes.
I'm still rolling on.
Okay. Now, are we still waiting for?
We'll be seeing her shortly. She has been on the start.
I don't think we can start.
We don't mind starting. Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right, here she is now.
Cheers. Oh, perfect.
Corey, I'm so sorry. But I didn't bring my daughter down.
Oh.
I forgot it was Monday. And she was watching my voice today, but I just they walked in and I was like, oh my goodness.
No worries.
Show me
the next. Okay. Yeah. Grab her someone else.
Right? She's at home.
So thank you. Does everyone know everyone, or should we introductions or we're all set, right?
Only one person I don't know.
And
Callie.
Hi Callie, she's there, our newest select board member. This is Callie. So from the other side of town, Jonesbrook, and her husband Sean is on the road.
And
the second
assistant fire chief.
Yeah, fire chief. So.
What's your last name?
Strader.
Okay.
I don't think you introduced yourself.
I'm Jamie. Jamie's the chair of the trustees for the library.
And I'm Corey. See you in the library.
Elizabeth Burt.
Yes.
She,
yep.
Okay. And then we have from the Historical Society.
Denise Cameron.
And Elliot Oldford. And we actually have another library trustee in the back.
Jennifer, would you? No, I'm under the weather.
All right, so well, thank you everyone for taking the time to come tonight. So the trust, the library trustees, will let you guys kind of go first. I mean, you've been working on all sorts of things. So why don't you let us know where you're at and what you're thinking, and when you all have some questions and comments, I'm sure.
Okay. So we've been working on a budget, and Elizabeth and Corey were kind of masterminds behind the budget. So I think, could you bring some extra copies?
I did.
Elizabeth, to pass out.
We made a subcommittee.
A subcommittee.
A subcommittee consisting of all the trustees that's meeting every other month to talk specifically about them, but that's in addition to our regularly scheduled board meetings. And that now has a subcommittee for community engagement.
Yes.
So it's gonna, I don't know how often you guys are meeting, but
I don't think we can tell. And there was also a subcommittee for coming up with the budget.
Right.
Yes. Which is, you two are the subcommittee.
Pretty much. Yes.
They are budget subcommittee.
Being more five, you know? We're trying to add as much bureaucracy as we can. So the numbers in here are very tentative. We just want to find out if we're kind of all in the same ballpark. And we do have a number of questions. And a few questions, feel free to ask them as we go. For personnel, we're thinking we'll need a little bit more Corey as we're doing the move. We're doing a few extra hours for about 6 months. We're preparing for the move and getting settled. We initially added custodial wages, and then we moved that down to maintenance, where that is currently in our budget. It's a little different, structured a little differently than the town hall. We divided this into moving expense, which is a one-time expense, and then ongoing expenses. You know, if we open more hours in a bigger space, heating and electricity is going to be more, and so forth. We didn't put anything for capital improvements because we understand you have a plan for the town hall and we don't know what that looks like. So we really didn't have enough information to put it over there, and we're hoping that you could fill in that gap for us.
Sure.
Moving expenses, again, we were talking about whether we need to rent a U-Haul, if we're going to load up our cars, if we're going to have a bucket brigade of boxes of books right down the street.
Just in boxes,
horses, horse-drawn books. So, you know, I think that's probably a minimal expense if we rent a U-Haul, but we weren't quite sure what your thinking was. New furniture and shelving is really the big expense here, especially if, given the initial thoughts that we've gotten from the community about wanting to maintain the town hall as a meeting space, we have to have modular, movable pieces, and that comes at a pretty big penny. So there's a little bit of thought there, but again, we haven't really done a lot of community engagement. We've just gotten some feedback at town meeting and just from conversations with neighbors.
So how was, I guess that's a good question. What are you hearing out there?
Most of the people want to keep it as a multi-function space. That's what I've been hearing. People don't want to lose it as a gathering space or, you know.
Yeah.
I find when you say library, a certain image pops in people's head of stacks and stacks of books, but when you kind of explain, actually libraries are way more of a hub for a community space, meeting many different needs, providing services and resources, people get a lot more excited. If they're thinking about it of, you know, we want to know what it is you want to see in the village here, and then figure out how we can be that for the community, rather than we're just going to move all our books in there and you aren't going to be allowed to use it as anything other than reading space. So I would say, you know, overall, it's been positive.
We've heard interest in a children's space, a teen space, a cafe space. There are a lot of ideas out there. I think it's going to be tough to narrow down and accommodate all of the visions that people have. So I think we're just going to have to be very flexible and you know, make it multifunctional.
Yeah, I think that's consistent with what I've been hearing, you know, because it's out there and people are talking about it. And so there is...
You made the paper twice?
Yeah.
It will
again. So I think one of the things is, this key is good communication. Letting people know, you know, nothing has been decided, but these are the, this is how change could start. It's a process, and we're trying to define that process and get some ideas about what might or might not work there. But certainly maintaining a meeting area has been one of the important things that I hear from people. But also I hear people are looking for that central space, the, you know, that town area to, for other activities to happen. So I think so far it's been certainly positive.
I think when people hear more about it and they start to think more about it, they see how the two missions of the library and the town hall complement each other and instead of negating each other.
Yeah, that's an accurate statement.
The next line item is architectural and interior design. Do you want to talk about that?
Sure, yeah.
So at the library conference in May, there was a big door prize of getting a free one-day on-site architectural consulting from Black River Design in Montpelier. And they drew the prize, and Waterbury Library won it. So, you know, they just got the brand new library. So they came and found me at lunch and said they heard that we could probably use it, so they passed it along to us. So
great.
Yes.
That's nice. Great.
Yeah.
So I've been in touch with Black River Design just to let them know that we're likely taking the summer to really get some feedback from the community and come up with a vision of what we want to see, and then have them come in early fall probably to kick that process off. But I certainly don't think one day will probably.
Right,
but
I
think
that'll give you an idea. They probably get us going pretty well. In the right direction. We're interested in possibly getting an engineering consultation. I looked at a report that Cheryl gave me. But in talking to people, someone on the PTO suggested that we need to do a dead load analysis because it's been evaluated for live load. So I don't know if there's a cost, what kind of cost is associated with that, and I'll try to get it for free from her network. She indicated that her husband and some of his friends might be able to help us out with that. Legal consultation, we're doing a title search.
Yes.
And there are some expenses associated with that. I don't think realtors are going to charge us to come in. Some of these are from prior discussions. We were talking about getting rid of the piano.
And
because it can't be too.
And getting a, right, yeah, that piano is dead.
But we think someone on front porch will just pick it up for free.
But we'd also would like, we've talked about potentially having a piano that does work in the town hall for, mm-hmm. you know, whatever events would benefit from having a piano.
Trash,
so it could be moving in and moving out.
It could be. Trash removal, I don't know if the town, what the rates you get for trash removal, and I'm hoping we piggyback on that. We based this on home residential service rates that we were aware of. Building maintenance, we probably want to do a real deep clean before we move in, and then ongoing cleaning. And especially now that it's being freshly painted, we budgeted for getting it power washed annually so we can keep it looking beautiful. Equipment maintenance, we had, were envisioning that as more of a hub, we'll probably need some more computers and laptops and notebooks and things like that. And phone, we didn't know if there's
DSL over there?
There is.
We understand there's a phone line that's the same.
When phone number is the line. It used to be that it was the same phone number as the library. You would take a Jack a phone over there as mm-hmm. Jack, and it was the same as the library phone number. Is that still the same?
No. No, I mean, it's all you had to do is call and have help turn on.
Okay.
Yeah. Great.
So that 300 can probably be eliminated. The rest of these are really ongoing expenses that we tried to estimate. You know, electricity and heating, we had looked at a fire department and a town garage.
I think we have
budgets,
more.
So that's.
We've had stuff that we used year-round when we had the other group in the high school that was there. So I think we have some fairly accurate
on
what it costs per year to to heat it. And I think
great.
Smell it.
I think I may have found like a $30,000 grant for maybe that we could use for new furniture and stuff. It's a library grant.
Wow.
We'll see.
Cheryl, you're a rock star.
So I think this is a good start to the process, just to open up people's eyes that, all right, this is what we're thinking, but it's not free. It's
right.
not. It's going to cost some money. I think that's good to have in the conversation. But as Cheryl just mentioned, there's lots of other
mm-hmm.
revenue sources out there that we can potentially tap.
Mm-hmm.
And then what I would envision is that would go along with the town vote, whether you want this or not, and that would be really the answer, is if you vote specifically for an expenditure, whether it's $42,000 or whether it's $50,000, whatever it happens to be, that will give us that answer. All right, this is what the townspeople want, and this is how we'll move forward. But I'm encouraged by what you're hearing, and also that you have a subcommittee on communication. So that's one of the things that needs to start ramping up. But it would be nice, and you know, we talked about having initially we're looking at town meeting next spring to hopefully, all right, and get a yay or nay on this. So I think, you know, the sooner that you start ramping up some of that communication and just getting the ideas in, all right, what else is about people thinking, you know, for that space. Again, it's not a done deal, but this is what we're thinking. What do you think as well? And then we've got obviously the Historical Society as well, who had, they were in last meeting, and had concerns, and we'll have on more questions and concerns that we'll be looking at as well.
Mm-hmm. And we had met with the Historical Society at our May meeting, was it?
April?
Mm-hmm. April. To talk to them about
in March,
you know,
even March.
Was
we came in March.
Oh, it was in March.
And then I think Ellie came in April, right? Is that right?
I think I came in first one.
Yeah.
Okay. To talk about, you know, we wanted to just look at how that they would be welcome to, you know, if we had like a dedicated area, we could put some of the books, you know, historical books with some of their collection to make it more accessible. So We've all been trying to.
That's great. That's
keep
awesome.
Keep the communication open between our groups.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to make a suggestion or two in
sure.
the budgetary area.
Please.
First, thank you very much for putting this together. It's very helpful to have something to look at. We can certainly refine the ongoing expense numbers by looking at what we spend now on the town hall and on the library.
Mm-hmm.
But I wanted to talk about our overall approach to budgets, because we generally find ourselves very, very constrained. And I admired what you said about pressure washing the town hall every year to keep it beautiful. But there's a reason that we have not pressure washed the town hall every year, which is something that we generally can't afford to do something.
Okay.
So when you generate numbers, there are nice to haves, and the more likely way it will go if we do this.
Right.
So I'd just like to ask that you keep that in mind. It sure would be nice if we washed the building every year. Because it sure would, but...
Yes.
So that's my suggestion there. The other is, as you develop this, there are other scenarios that can be looked at as well. And it could be evolutionary, and it also could be something that leads to different stopping points depending on what seems appropriate as we get there. An example, and I have no idea if this is practical or not, which is something a lot of people think about, is can some of the functions of the library, for example, the book collection, be kept where it is and run programs out of the town hall? And what difference does that make in expenses? And one can evolve into the other. So just things I'd like to ask you to think about, and you probably have.
It's kind of our status quo mm-hmm. right now, honestly, because there is no space for parking programs where the books are. So mm-hmm. I run the programs either from the school or the town hall already. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's just kind of the model that we've been using. And it's nice in the fact that we are out there in the community, mm-hmm. but it's also a one more layer of logistics, and people often get confused and come to the library when they're supposed to be at the school or the town hall. So mm-hmm. there's some drawbacks too. Mm-hmm. That's sort of where we're at right now.
In addition, I thought that the reason we were doing this was to cut down on the number of buildings, and that mm-hmm. would not fit the bill. So we were going under that assumption that, in addition to the fact that that is a space that offers a lot more to the library, mm-hmm. we were helping to cut expenses to the town by having just one building instead of two.
But I hear what you're saying about sort of the evolutionary. We did talk about in this equipment line item with the computers that we might not start off with five, you know, three laptops mm-hmm. and two desktops, but we could start off with a desktop and a couple laptops and see, you know, what the demand is like. Mm-hmm. You know, if we have long waiting lists for computer use, then maybe we need more. If we don't, then maybe that's the right size. Mm-hmm. I certainly see the advantages of doing it that way.
So what's your next step?
Actually, before we go on to that, I'd really like to hear from the Historical Society.
Can I say one thing too?
Yeah.
Also, I'm the one that's doing all the maintenance and cleaning at the town hall, so I don't know if that'll factor into keeping cleaning. Because if it's not just their events, they shouldn't be the ones that have to clean right. after other people.
Yes.
But to add that into, or mm-hmm. take it out of their... But we want if people were having events, we'd want to make it part of the event fee, whatever the cleaning.
Yeah, is. But I would still be paid to do right. it. Is what I'm saying. Okay. So it wouldn't necessarily be in your budget. It would be in the mm-hmm. town hall.
Yeah. Yeah. Last meeting, it sounded like the Historical Society had some legitimate concerns. So I've been talking about that again.
Well. At this meeting right now, I just heard Corey said that there would like to be a teen area and a juvenile area and an adult area, and it's fine to have all of these community center in the town hall, but we only have what we have right there. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's as much room as we have, and so I think we've got to. And I don't know how you can do this, but designate areas or, I'm just worried that if the library moves in there, which, and I'm not saying that they don't need more space and they don't need more parking, they don't need a bathroom, I think they do. But if I'm worried that if they move in there, it's going to be the library and the community events, the anything that has to do with the community, like a dance or a band concert or anything, is not going to be able to happen because the library is there. And I think people are going to get to have the feeling that, oh, this is the library, we can't do anything else there.
So, can I address that? So, Cory didn't say that's what we want. I said that those are some of the ideas that we're hearing. But the first idea that we're hearing is that people want it to be maintained for a variety of events. So I was saying that we just need to be as flexible as possible and make sure the space is really versatile. But that's the thing I think we've heard most from people in the community is that they want it to be available for dances or bands or concerts and things like that. And we have an open mic night there, which we certainly don't use. That's a really popular program.
Right. I just don't want to lose that space or lose the people feeling that they can't do anything there because it's now the library.
I think we're all on the same page.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Here's the list.
Yeah.
and you guys have the list from last time.
Are they two different lists?
No.
Same list.
I brought the same list that they have. You said last time that you were going to put this to a vote for their people. You were going to do a questionnaire. Has that gone out or is that?
No, so we were waiting for a few reasons. The first was we wanted to put this draft budget in front of the select board because if they were like, whoa, absolutely no way, then we wouldn't have put a bunch of work into getting the community involved and interested in and on board. And the second was I was able to attend a great series of workshops at the conference on community engagement that has some really solid planning tools behind it that really works to get meaningful input from the community. So I'm pretty excited about doing that. So we're meeting next week, the community engagement subcommittee, to really flesh out a timeline and a plan. And the friends are going to be involved also because it's going to take a little bit of people power to get out there and actually have the meaningful conversations that really get the feedback. So there will be some form of online questionnaire, but it certainly won't be the only thing we're going to do.
Okay, so it'd be like online?
No, I think we'll do sort of online awareness. We'll do one-to-one conversations with people. We're going to do some like stakeholder meetings, so obviously it'd be great to do one with the Historical Society. We're going to do some community resource mapping, so just more formally thinking about who out there have skills that could help us make this happen. So it'll be a whole variety of ways for people to get involved.
I'm thinking, Denise, are you thinking a paper questionnaire?
That's what I was thinking.
That's what I was hearing, unspoken.
Yeah. Yeah, it's the old-fashioned newspaper.
So I think that's something the subcommittee would certainly take into account.
And maybe, I don't know, leave them around town at different locations or where people could pick them up and get them back to the committee? And
yes.
Could we do a townwide mailing, maybe? I mean, that would be something you guys could explore. So we get everyone?
We have a whole group.
Yes. Yes.
Right.
And any with the property taxes?
Yeah.
Do you want to No, because not everybody pays for it. Some people are renters.
True.
And certainly some kind of other community engagement meetings type
things. Some design nights we thought about. We could actually have them in the town hall so people could stand in there and think about what it could look like.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
And I was too early to think about applying for a grant at this time because, I mean, your questionnaire or anything hasn't gone out. But, you know me, I'm always financial thinking. Does the library have any friends money or anything that you would be spending towards this project or
so there,
match for a match on the
yeah,
shelf?
Yeah, there is friends money. They have talked about supporting us with the title search, depending on what we end up having to pay for that.
And so far, most of the commitment I've gotten out of the Friends group is really just willing to like go out into the community and get the feedback. But I'm sure as sort of the fundraising arm, they would be willing to sort of take that on. I also write grants too, so I would be happy to think about it, even though we might not be ready to apply for it.
Yeah. The one that I was looking at, when there were two or three of them for library, for stationary shelving, as long as it was a permanent, you know, not temporary. But I didn't look and see what the match was. On any grant, there's a match.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Could be 25%.
The Friends do have some money, and I've been thinking in my mind, and we haven't even discussed it yet, really, but that sometime down the road when we got some more concrete fundraising goals, we would probably then ask the Friends to help us with that.
They always like, whenever you do a grant application, they want to know what our share will be, how you commit that money. You know, is that money definitely committed? In other words, they're not giving us a grant that we can't do because we can't come up with the money, you know, for the township and stuff, so. Mm-hmm. That's something to think about sooner than later.
Yes.
Okay.
Then on the agenda.
I'm just curious, have you seen the Historical Society's list yet?
No.
No, okay.
No.
Can we want to have a discussion here?
No.
Well, why don't we? Yeah.
No.
Got
one more on there? It's got one. It's
Yeah, we can. Why don't we just pass that there? There
I can print
that list on.
Yeah, we can get it run to the.
It's still on sale. I don't want to pay that.
We'll get your
shot. Mm-hmm.
They're going to give it to him.
So, any other questions or concerns right off, Denise? And we know there's a list of stuff, but again, we're trying to keep our, at this point, kind of broad, just knowing that there are no decisions that have been made or will be made. It's just a process that we're all trying to be involved in.
Right, right. And I think that's a good thing, just to get together and talk and...
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Throw ideas around. Do you have anything that...
No, I just wanted to be here to see what's going on. And she has her list, and we had sort of went over that
can,
last time.
I can,
I'll print one up and give it to her,
okay.
Since I live right across the street. That's a lot of my concern. I hate to see the thing just fall apart and be looking at an empty house.
I don't think any of us want a dilapidated building in town.
This does bring up another thing that has nothing to do with the library, but we were talking at one of the meetings, town meeting or whatever, about making this a town street, you know, from the store up to Frank's with improvements for businesses and stuff like that. Is that a
downtown designation?
Yes.
Yeah.
Did anything happen with that?
We have that.
Well, that
is anybody doing anything with it?
Actually, that opens us up for more grants. We have applied for another grant, and Katrina's applied for another grant to the designation for the tennis courts, to repair the tennis courts. And
because we have that designation, we were allowed to apply for this rec grant. We hadn't had it. It just opens up opportunities for us.
Right. Yeah.
It's not anything that they're going to give us.
No, but it's nice to see a street in a town that used to be kind of mediocre all of a sudden look nice. And there are places in Vermont where that's happened. Not that we don't look nice now.
Another thing I've always hoped, and I got for a grant for it once, but FEMA wanted, the catch was that FEMA wouldn't give us any money for the town hall, for the old town office, we couldn't build this one, so we turned it down, but was to make a park where the old town office was, you know, for bicycles and benches and things like that. That's another opening that we're hoping to do for down the road, if we get the sidewalks.
Right, and the sidewalks are October? That's the rumor I heard from.
We have the last easement signed, yes, and they're working on their way to property tax transfers for the temporary easements, and so.
And we're working on a grant for the other side already.
Our bills are up to rate.
She guys give some to me, she's like, wait, free money.
Are low-interest loans part of that program as well?
It is for homeowners.
Good.
I can send you the, what we get out of it, I'll send it to you.
Infrastructure loans, such as sewer and everything like that. But we don't need that kind of stuff, it's all kinds, all different kinds of grants.
Very good, so, in fact, the next steps, so we've seen, you know, we'll, I mean, certainly a budget at this point, you know, it's a nice number, but it doesn't mean, just, again, opens everyone's eyes, it's gonna cost, money when we do it, there are grants available, and those are the type of things that we have available for the public when we go to vote on this. But, so you will be working on community engagement, I guess, next is probably one of your.
Through the summer, well, that more fast could be a good opportunity to, do some, you know, 5-10 minute surveys.
What's the date of more fast?
It's the 15th of September, I believe.
Yes, it is.
Glad I got it right.
Is there a rain date?
There's no rain date.
As of yet.
So is there any other questions, the board, Ray, John, Kelly, John, Jason, have for anyone? Or you guys for us, or need anything?
When should we come back?
Why don't you actually figure out your community engagement, what you're doing there, send us an email, and then let's set up a time so that we can kind of consult on what you've been hearing out there.
Okay. So like August, September?
I was gonna say sometime beginning of September, something like that.
That sounds good.
So we're getting the thumbs up to move forward with community engagement.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Because that was our big question.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. I have another question. The Historical Society, are they involved in the subcommittee?
No, but.
Be welcome to, if you would like.
I think it would be a good idea.
It's so far, Corey and Karen shared both, so it's a
vengeance.
It's a variance.
You let us know. You don't need to be on the spot.
Okay.
You let us know.
It might be something you might enjoy and to be involved in that way. You're
right.
Because
yeah.
What's really important in this whole process is getting out the correct information. Mm-hmm. And if you're part of the whole process, I think people would have comfort in knowing that it's coming from you as well. So, that would be helpful if you can somehow help out with that. That would be great.
Okay. Have you set a meeting time yet?
It's Tuesday at 4 o'clock.
Tuesday.
Next week. Right? Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow.
Next.
No, sorry. 26th. At the end of the school year, I'm a little scattered.
All right. Well, thank you, everyone. If there's anything in the meantime, if you have questions, concerns, you know, for Cheryl or just call us directly, however you want to do it. If you just have a question, you know, give us a call.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So you were sending out the social media policy for Ray.
Again. I already sent
it. All right, so it's got it. So now we'll cover
the Facebook as well.
The Facebook as well. So now we're looking at subdivision regulations. We need to set a date for a public hearing, which we can have coinciding with one of our select board meetings. And it needs to be, there's the timing issue with the number of days, because it needs to be something after and before the November election.
I mean, 15 days from before the hearing to set the date, so.
So it has to be at least 15 days from now?
Mm-hmm.
Time.
Mm-hmm. All right, so why don't we talk about the July schedule, and then we can do the subdivision hearings on one of those dates. There was a suggestion in here, perhaps moving the meeting from July
2nd.
2nd to the 9th.
Cheryl and I were just talking, it could be, it's like a long holiday weekend.
Yeah, it makes sense.
I don't know if I agree with that.
Well, no, that's fine. I won't be around on that. Will three people be here? Because if three people can be here, anyway, you'd have it.
I guess I was planning on being here, but I could go either way, you know. I'm not married to a meeting on the 2nd.
Yeah, I mean, I don't...
I could be here if you want, if you really think we need to have one, but I just don't like tonight.
What do you think, John? I mean, you've been around for...
Yeah, I mean, it's an exception if the money falls on a holiday, and the holiday's not until Wednesday, but...
Yeah, I think I'd rather not have it before the holiday weekend, too.
Okay.
But then doesn't that put us 2 weeks in a row?
You'll have one on the 9th.
One on the 16th.
And then one on the 16th.
Okay, well, everybody else is okay with it.
It really doesn't matter to me.
You could do it later in the week, not Monday night. You could do it on the 5th.
No, I think if you're gonna do it, you'll do it either the 2nd or the 9th. I just think for everyone that's around this table, it's scheduled. I mean, it's more of a courtesy to hear. I don't think anyone will come to the meeting where you're gonna miss anything, but...
Actually, since there are 5 Mondays in July, if it was on the 9th and the 23rd, then it would be every 2 week schedule.
Well, then we're really...
Then you're changing things around.
Well, because of the extra Monday in July, you don't. Then it gets...
Well, no, I mean, the select board meeting is the 1st and 3rd of Monday, unless the Monday is a holiday.
Yes. Okay.
So, if you want to call it quasi-holiday, that's fine. But that's not.
Right.
Well, yeah. Do we need a motion? I'll make a motion that we move the meeting to the 9th.
I'll second it. Any further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
So, that being said, so we'll be on the 9th and the 16th. When would people most like to have us? Is that a public hearing?
I should be on the 9th, unless you...
The 9th is fine.
Yeah.
Will that be here?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll just have it. We've cut out about 15 minutes of the meeting before.
Right. Mm-hmm. Now, John is already here, so then you'll only have...
What's that?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's what we'll see there. All right, now we have the Blodgett decision. So why don't we, that's something we'll need to go into executive session to discuss. So I would move to go into executive session to discuss the Blodgett decision.
I'll make the motion that we approve the document provided by Paul Gillis regarding laying down a new trail and discontinuing a portion of the
I'll second that.
Great, seconds. Any further discussion? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right, the ayes have it. Unanimous. So that, if everyone can please sign this, Ray, you can start. Make sure that book's done.
Did you talk at all about the ordinance? That's in the stipulation.
We know we have to do that.
Yeah.
So you want to put that in minutes in case
ordinance will be addressed.
Yeah. All right, so let's move ahead to the any other old business.
Well, I'm just going to, just wanted to say one more thing about the whole grievance thing. I wasn't pointing anything, but I just want to make sure. I mean, there's so many parties involved in this. And, bottom line is I think CAI just didn't do a very good job. It really boils down to it. But I know that the listers, I felt, were very cordial with all the grievance hearings.
Cheryl, did you have, you're here for, there must be something.
Just listening.
Just listening.
Listening in, I've been dealing with a lot of the taxpayers that have been coming in very upset. And I have been doing nothing but deed research for all of these people. To the point where I'm not even able to keep up on my own work right now. And I understand that CAI, because I work with them myself, asks for deeds and things like that. But if a survey was not, you know, say Comart and had a survey labeled in there and we would label them with your name, they're gonna find it. But without going back and doing major deed research, they weren't gonna find it. And I just feel like some of that could have been done prior. And there's a lot of very upset people. Very upset, to the point where I thought they were gonna literally come over the counter. And you know, on the face that they see, and I feel bad for them. And all we can do is help them, but it's really, that's all I'm doing. That's what I did tonight when I came in. That's all I'm able to do. And I don't think that, you know, I'm not pointing any fingers either, but I do know that some of it, I'm finding the majority of it right now.
You're finding the majority of it is just lack of
research. And you know, how far CAI was supposed to go, I don't know. But I know that a lot of them were, you know, they're pretty simple searches, and there are descriptions, you know, that surveys have been done, and there's degrees, and I just think that maybe if we'd done a little bit more research before notices went out, maybe some notices wouldn't have happened. But I'm not that person, I just know that what I'm seeing right now.
I think there's pretty broad agreement with what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm doing, Sasha and I mean, there's times where I have 3-4 people standing in here and Katrina and Cheryl have to come out and help me because I just can't keep up. And I feel bad if there's going to be somebody that I don't have time to do it with. It's just...
Do you have any suggestions for anything the board can do to...
I don't think there's anything. I think it's already been done. Unfortunately. And I'm just, we're having to deal with it now.
Well, something that came up earlier, you thought that Cheryl might have a list of those people who are encountering problems or having grievance hearings and what the outcomes are. And if we kept that list handy, if we need any numbers to have a discussion with CAI, it would be good to have that.
I have all the lists.
Great.
I think it would be a really great idea if the select board, someone called CAI and says, hey, you know, because you as a select board are on a BCA, maybe they should come sit on these grievances, because I literally have one grievance right now that has nothing to do with the tax map. All the rest of them are tax maps.
That was pretty much the same as grievances.
And I think that we need to have, you know, not we, they the taxpayer. And the BCA now, because now we have to, you know, go up upon what the listeners had already decided. I think that we all need explanation, you know, and I know what Mike has said, but...
I think we should have them actually to this, a select board meeting, CAI.
CAI?
Or, yes.
So, originally the listeners were asked to come in tonight, but they weren't available to come, so they said that they could come to the first meeting in July. So, would you like me to ask them to have CAI come as well?
Absolutely. And then we'll have those budget numbers that you talked about earlier as far as, you know, what is this whole process costing us? Because, you know, there's certainly this going to always be, and I don't know, Cheryl, Lynn, if you have, and it sounds like you're busy enough, but if you have an opportunity, if you talk to some of your people, or you can send an email out to the town clerk community. Ask other towns if they've done this and they've seen the same number of or percentage of mistakes, if you will, that come back or appeals. I mean, there's going to be some, but it's going to be a number whether, you know, are we close to what normally comes back, or is this?
Well, this is different. We are doing the tax maps. Every other town in the state of Vermont has been ordered to do the tax maps. We're the first one. We're ahead of the game. We lost a grant because we're ahead of the game.
you know, to help pay for some of this, but I don't think you can compare other towns to what's happened here.
Well, if they've done new tax maps, so we're the only town that's done new tax maps?
Well, it doesn't happen very often.
Well, I know there's one town out there, I'm not sure which town it is, because there was just...
Well, just for an example, I mean, yeah. You know, are they off, are they getting 50% coming back, or is it, you know, closer to what we're getting? Mm-hmm. That would be helpful when we meet with CIA or CAI, so that we can, you know, say, you know, what's the discrepancy here? I mean, is this normal or is this shoddy work? That's what I'm getting at.
Well, I think that, I mean, I haven't read the contract, but I would think that somewhere in the contract it would state how much deed research they actually go back on. Mm-hmm. And
they don't say how much.
And my other question would be is if they are, when they are doing their mapping, are they going and taking degrees off from deeds or just surveys that are on file? Because there's a lot of deeds that have actual survey and boundary markers and pins and points in their deeds, but they never recorded it here. So were they taking that and putting that into their system as well as the milers that we have? That would be one of my big questions, because I don't know that, and a lot of the people that are coming in and asking me, well, how come the town is not taking that if CAI took that? Well, I don't know if they took that.
They're doing both, by what Mike said.
I don't know.
They're taking it. He said that they were taking information from the deeds, maps, digital data, and property cards, and they were laying them over a digital program that would compute the meets and bounds to the footage. Right, John? Did I say that right?
Yeah.
So it doesn't say anything in here. It said it's the responsibility of the town to make available existing deeds, maps, digital data, property record cards, property transfer records, and subdivisions, and any other existing data that CAI deems necessary for successful completion of this project. See, that doesn't say surveys or anything, so.
I thought I heard deeds.
I'm sorry?
I thought I heard deeds.
Yes, but deeds don't always have the degrees or anything.
Right.
Whoever you bought a house from would say, being the same lands as.
Yeah. And then you go back and it says turn left at the house.
So if they went back into the 20s, if they made all the surveys available, then wouldn't everyone that has a survey in the belt not be wrong?
Say again?
So if the listers gave CAI everything that was in the vault,
the surveys.
Yeah, everything that's recorded, the surveys, wouldn't all those people that have surveys not be wrong? Like, wouldn't they not be getting a letter?
That seems like just what happened in my case and a lot of other cases. When we brought in surveys, it was changed.
Because we had surveys in the mall, so ours should have been wrong in the first place, is what I'm...
Right. I mean, it seemed like what they were asking was provided. Why wasn't the...
Everything. It seems like everything wasn't.
That's my other question to be, how far back
did you use surveys?
Even more than that, you would think a basic part of the process would be, here is the old tax map. If what you have is different from the old tax map, why is it different?
Exactly.
And it sounds like 95% of these errors would have been found that way.
Exactly.
So that is a very simple process, and if that didn't happen...
Well, it's not simple.
But you have somewhere to start.
It's a clear step that should be
taken.
It's a clear step that should have been taken before the tax maps were
finished.
Right.
You know, when you send out 650 letters,
mm-hmm.
there's something wrong in Denmark.
I have 900 parcels.
I
guess my question, my biggest question to CAIs of the whose responsibility was it to be doing this deed research so we didn't have so many upset people. I mean, we're looking at mm-hmm. 20 acres, 200 acre difference.
I know, and that would fall under their contract, I think. It's,
mm-hmm.
But that's what we'll... In the meantime, I mean, if you can provide everyone a copy of the contract just so everyone on the board has an opportunity to read it,
yes.
That would be be.
Oh, yeah, okay.
I'm also curious if there are any performance measures in that contract.
It's going to be hard too, with the, you know, the brief of the tax appeals coming up and not having the answer to the board.
Well, that question there, you can get with Mike and ask him, or just send it directly to CAI. Those technical questions that you need now, write them down, get them to Cheryl, and we'll send them out, you know, copy Mike, but ask Mike to get questions, Mike and Deborah, that we need those for the grievances.
The select board wants answers to these before the grievances.
Exactly.
Okay.
The DBA board, ourselves, take the board.
Have they been paid in full?
Yeah. $44,400.
So that's nothing we can do there until we.
Right.
Only going forward, and that's why I asked the board that at this point you are on the same wavelength that I am, that when there are errors to be fixed, we shouldn't have to be putting more money into it at this point right now, unless we have different answers that they didn't get what they needed or whatever.
Right. Mm-hmm. All right, so that does the Lister stuff and these grievances. And again, Cheryl Lynn, I'm sorry for all the extra work that you've incurred, but I'm sure everyone appreciates all the extra work and help that you're helping them get through the process.
It's too bad that it happened.
Oh, no, it really is, and unfortunately it has, and we just have to move forward and try to get some answers as to why it happened and what other help or such that we can get for what we've done. All right, so let's go ahead and approve the minutes from June 4th, 2018.
I'll make a motion to approve the minutes June 4th, 2018.
Is there a second? Kelly seconds.
I had a couple.
John?
I knew we had something.
Morrison type of decision. She got great.
General public comment on page 2. So there are too many Johns there. So John Siegel is JL.
Oh,
okay.
I gotcha.
So when I said I would try to make it.
Yep.
Okay, but then John spoke about putting the vote on the Australian ballot. That would have been JL.
Yeah, John. Yeah.
And then on page 3, number 2 under Town Administrator Report, that last sentence is kind of funky. I'm not sure what you...
John spoke about the fire department needing to let Cheryl know ahead of time for changes. I see what you're saying.
In case grant funds can offset the additional costs?
Yes.
Like that? Okay.
So about... This shouldn't be there. I got you.
Okay.
Thank you, John.
Sure.
Any other changes or amendments? All in favor, vote aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right. So we've already done the July meeting schedule. We've already talked about this meeting on the 2. Joyce is going to be here. So unless there's any other thing anyone wants to hop on, I would move to adjourn after we've signed everything.
Oops.
Oh,
it's
a
good night, everyone.
Good night, Cheryl.
We meet again before the 4th, right? No, we don't.
No.
Everybody have a nice, safe 4th.
Same to you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
So, Don, why is Water Grade 4 all different? Like later time, rusty car?
I don't know, maybe I'll find out more than you.
You don't know? I'm kind of excited that it's different.
Actually, I think it's better when it's later.
It is.
Yeah, me too.
Because everything goes together, before you have to go, then you leave.
Right.
Yeah, then he doesn't come back and...
What's that?
What's that?
The parade is later.
Not quite Independence Day.
It's like at 4. And then everything starts on Rusty Park, nothing on Water Grade. Did you see, oh, you didn't see that.
Oops, sorry.
Figure out how middle school is going to work in the future. And I'm the parent from Moortown.
Good.
It starts this week.
No change.
No change. I'll tell them. I'm pretty sure Peter and Gabe were
change. People would not like change.
That's for sure.
This is next year.
Yeah.
All good, everyone?
Yep.
All right. Well, all in favor of adjourned.
Yep.